Hey guys, I'm Voylan, and yes, I'm using the same kind of like transition effects like in my previous part, but that's because I filmed this on the same day because I want to film as much as possible in a short time. But anyway, let's start. Welcome to the next part in which we will get the frame number, like the total amount of video frames. This is part of a total series on how to make a video player inside of Godot. So if you want to follow along with the series, I really recommend starting at part 1. And first of all, let's go over to our sponsor. Oh yeah, my channel is still too small. But luckily, I have a Ko-fi page. Thanks to these wonderful people, I've been able to keep doing this as kind of like a job. Making tutorials, working on Gozen, and doing YouTube in general. Because this channel is still not monetized, so my Ko-fi supporters is basically my main income right now. Yeah. Oh well, anyway, let's start with the video. Let's first go over into our video.hpp file, because we need a new function. Let's put it underneath. So, we need an integer. We need to get an integer and get total frame number. Let's just call it like this. Let's create a new function here, a new byte method. Get total frame number, voila. Let's copy this function and let's go over to video.cpp because that's basically all we need to do. Okay, so video. And first of all, we can just return a vstream video. I think frames, number of frames. So we could just do this. If you were to do this, let's quickly build. Let's also copy this function real quick. Let's go into Godot and yeah, basically let's comment this one out. We don't need this for now. Print video.getTotalFrameNumber. If you run this, we have around 600 frames inside of this video, and this could actually be reasonably correct, if I'm not mistaken, because that video is exactly 20 seconds long at 30 frames per second, so that is actually very close. But sadly, this is not always as close. So let's make a utility functions print. And let's just print this number so we can see and compare. Work and let's return 0 for now. Let's create a new integer here. Frame count. First of all, we need to check if the video is open. So print error video isn't open yet. Next up, what do we need to do here? First of all, a column. You may remember the avseek function. We seek from a specific specific point. So we have av any and av seek flag backwards, and we will be using backwards. The problem is, if you have a video of over 1 million frames, by example, it will have to go through every single frame before it gets the total amount. Out of what I've been able to test, it always has missing frames at the end of the video file. So we can actually skip almost all of them. So because we don't want to start searching, like if you have a video of like 10 million frames, we don't want to start from the beginning. We want to start seeking towards the end already with the seek flag backwards. So it takes a least amount of time to try and find the complete number of frames. Because like I said before, we need to go through every single frame and count them all together. So if AV stream video number of frames, MB frames, if that is bigger than 500, by example, you can change this to whatever you like. We set L frame count to basically this and minus 30. In my experience, it's mainly like 10 to 14 frames difference. So yeah, this will give the least amount of frames that we need to go manually through to check which are the kind of like bad frames at the end of the video. So next up, AV packets. Is av packet alloc, same for frame again, so basically the same thing that we've been doing the entire time already. Next up, we will actually go to the seek function inside of here. Video seeking. Voila, let's just copy paste this. Video seeking. So frame timestamp, a frame number. We don't have an a frame number, but we have an L frame count. So let's do this. Let's return it if we cannot seek to can't seek. Let's just say visual stream in here. And we don't need to go to the beginning. But we're not going to the beginning. I think I never changed this. So can't seek video file. Let's also replace this in here because we're not actually seeking to the beginning. That's still from the copy paste from the audio. So this should be seeking to that point in the video. So if the video is over 500 frames long, it will take the total amount of frames minus 30. So it only has 30 frames to go through. So now let's go through those frames to actually get the correct frame counts. So let's return the correct frame count here already. And let's create our while loop. And I think we could honestly just copy. Yeah, let's just copy this while loop because it's very much the same. Oh, whoops, let's not cut that. Let's just copy. In here, we paste it. We don't return the image. Be sure to, well, let's just say, let's start at the beginning of the while loop. So we need to read the frame, send the packet, receive the frame as well. Then we need to get the best effort timestamp, the presentation timestamp, but we don't need all of this data stuff. Over here, we could basically just have our frame count plus plus. And I think that's about it. I think that's about everything that we need. So let's quickly build this. This will probably be one of the shortest parts so far in this whole series. Every single video has been around 1 hour. Not today. So here you can see there's actually a difference. There's actually a difference of 12 frames. And I've been having that with almost all videos. So what it actually does, what FFmpeg actually does, is it gets an estimate according to the time and the amount of frames. This is not a variable frame rate video. A variable frame rate, let's quickly go in here to make it easier to talk to you guys. So a variable frame rate video, it's not what we're dealing with right now. We're actually dealing with a normal, steady frame rate video. The moment that you go to variable frame rate, then things become more complicated because then you don't know. Then you just need more data to be able to decide how to display the frames and what speed. How long do you show each frame on screen? And that can have an impact on the accuracy of the time, but this is just steady frames, a steady frame rate. So it's just taking the time, doing it times the amount of frames, and you get a number that's not really correct. So that's why we created this entire function to get a more accurate frame count. Because if you were to try to go to a frame that's beyond that, so let's quickly go into our Godot project. By example, we have until 588. We look up this number, we seek the frame, and we actually get an error. Invalid image, because that's the maximum. So we go to 7, and we have a usable image. Like this video goes black to dark towards the end. If you would put this on 60 by example to go a little bit before it becomes black, you can see it's actually still working. So getting to frame 600 of what FFmpeg says is possible, that's not the case. And that's why we made this function. And normally, even with like very giant video files, this won't really impact and won't really take that much time. It does not really require that much performance because we're not taking all the data out of it. Like, we're making the pointers to access the data, but that's about it. We just go over every single frame. If the frame actually exists, we count. And this is how I was able to solve the problem of not getting a total frame number. And we could easily have an extra function like get total frame number inaccurate, by example. If you just want a very quick, dirty way of getting a estimate, not a correct one, but an estimate in case that's needed for your application. But seeing that this function does not actually require that much like effort or processing power. We could possibly, if we notice like always like 12 frames or like always in that area, we could limit this to 20. I prefer to take it a little bit more safe and take 30. It still does not take that much time anyway. Like, how long does this take? Let's quickly test. So, start time. Time.getUSec. And over here, let's just print start time. Oops. Start time minus USec. Let's see what that does. That's a minus amount, so I probably should switch this over. It's not that big of like an amount. It does not take that much time. We should probably set this to msec. I don't think it's that big of a difference. So it takes about 21 milliseconds, which is not that much, and especially at this moment, you're probably still opening the video. This is actually something that we could possibly just have inside of the start function instead of open video. So we could just make it like this. In here, we make it like this. We create an other one that actually gets the frame count. And this one we call at the end of open video. So open video at the end, or at the after the video part would probably be better. So get total frame number. And in here we just make this an inline. In our header file, inline get total frame number. And let's actually create a new integer. Total frame number. Let's put this on 0. This should not return an in, so this should just be a void. And this just returns total frame number. Oh, no. This should be an int, and the other one should be a void. Because we take this. That's how the error goes away. Yep. We go to video. We go to our frame seeking function. And L frame count, you basically don't need. Let's just take all these variables and let's replace them by total frame number. Whoops, that's a little bit too far. And this should work. We should change this to voids. And normally the video will be open at this point, so we don't actually need to run this video because this function is called, we don't need that part. We don't need that because it will be called before is open is actually true. And return total frame number. We don't actually need returns right now. Because this became a void, we're just changing the number directly. So that's basically it. So yeah, again, a big thank you for all my Ko-fi supporters who make this entire series possible. In the next couple of videos, we'll probably start working on the UI inside of Godot. So yay, finally, GDScript. I'm not certain that we will touch the whole GDExtension again from now on. I think most of it we can do from Godot, starting now. So in the next video, I'll show how to make it easy to like have the timeline to select from, the play button. Maybe I'll do a series after that with some extra functionality. But that will really depend if there are any suggestions and if people want to see more of this series or they have enough knowledge to go from there. But yeah, anyway, thank you for watching and I'll see you all in the next one. Bye bye. Yeah, I need to close my window again. Bye bye.